Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Queer Memoir panel. I'm your host, Nicole Georges. The first thing I want to do is have everybody go around and say your... I know you're from Australia. Hi. And have everybody say your name and what you do. I am a queer cartoonist and a memoirist. I started doing diary comics that I published about 20 years ago, and I have been self-publishing diary comics ever since. I'm on my 15th year of doing daily diary comics in May that I published as a split with my friend under the name Invincible Summer. And in 2013, my first full-length graphic memoir, Calling Dr. Laura, was released. It deals with family secrets, and it's 265 pages. Currently, I'm working on a graphic memoir called Fetch, How a Bad Dog Brought Me Home, about a bad dog that I had that changed my life. I teach comics for California College of the Arts, MFA in Comics program, and for Portland State University, and I've worked at the Center for Cartoon Studies. And now we're all here. So, I'd like to welcome my first contestant.
My name is Dylan Edwards. I have been doing comics for about 15 years or so. The book I'm going to be talking about during this panel is my book Transposes, which is a nonfiction comic about masculine-identified assigned female birth people, so trans men and AFAB genderqueer. And I interviewed several different people and adapted their stories for comics. So it's not exactly my memoir that is in here, but other people's memoir that I comicsified. I do a little bit about my own stuff, but that's usually kind of one-off little things. But this is kind of more of the big work of real-life stories of people. And right now, I'm doing the exact opposite of memoir, which is writing queer science fiction.
Yes.
Making up everything.
My name is Elizabeth Beier, and by day I'm a graphic designer for climate change-related nonprofits. And then I go home and make comic books about myself. They're called Bisexual Files and Errors, issues 1 and 2, with many more issues to come. And they're about like okay Cupid dates and things like that, crushes, obsessive crushes, that type of thing. And right now, in addition to these, I'm working on a larger book about the Lexington Club, which was San Francisco's last lesbian bar until it closed last week. Mm-hmm. And they're taking the sign down, and so I interviewed people and drew their portraits, flirted aggressively, got free drinks, and now I'm making a book.
My name is Miki. I graduated from the FIT illustration program, master program, 6 months ago, originally from Israel. I do mostly comics and graphic novels. My previous works weren't really about my sexuality. Recently, I've been working on a graphic novel called Full Body Scan, which is about my experiences as a combat soldier in the Israeli army combined with gay online dating in New York, how those two work together. It's issues of sexuality versus masculinity and gay dating in general, which, as you know, is not a picnic. Yeah, that's hopefully it'll be published in Europe next year. We're working on it. Still don't know about America.
Hope so.
I hope so. Yeah, we'll find a publisher. Hopefully. Yeah. Thank you for coming.
I'm Sara Leavitt. I live in Vancouver, in Canada, and I started doing comics about 10 years ago. So it's a little, you know, late bloomer. And I published a book in 2010 called Tangles, a story about Alzheimer's, my mother and me, which is what it is. And it's been published in different countries since then and translated into a couple different languages. I was really excited to come here for a lot of reasons, but partly because I don't often get to talk about the queer aspects of my work because the book includes parts of my life, and it's clear that I'm in a relationship with women and stuff, but it's just not the part of the book that gets talked about. And right now I'm working on a historical fiction, so yeah, not memoir, about a serial killer in the mid-1800s.
I'm A.K. Summers, and I don't know how long my comics career stretches, because I really started with zines and animation rather than comics proper. I used to do a zine called Negativa, and my book, Pregnant Butch, is my first full-length comic book. It came out last year. I'm working on, simultaneously, a coming-of-age story and a children's graphic novel are my current projects.
Great, thank you. Please welcome all of the presenters today. So I wanted to start off with a little bit of controversy. Have you ever gotten in trouble for your comics? We all work with true comics. I know that people always want to know how my family reacted to my book. That basically says, oh, my mom was such a horrible mom. And they want to know how she reacted, which was that she gave me a 1-star Amazon review. I've gotten in trouble at different points in time. When I was a teenager, I called out all these boys in my community for supporting a rapist, and I used all their first names, and I lost all my friends at once, and so that was a great lesson in changing people's names and things like that. So since then, I don't generally get in trouble. I tend to date such narcissists that they get excited if they're portrayed, even if they're portrayed badly. They're like, that's right, I'm in a comic. So it's Funky Winker meme. Anyway, so I want to know if you've ever gotten in trouble or a sticky situation based on your true comics. I'll start with Dylan.
I actually, at the beginning of working on Transposes, I did, so I interviewed several people, but the understanding from the beginning was that I was going to change their appearance for the, like, I was going to do a separate character design that didn't look like their real life existence, and I was going to give them a pseudonym. And even with that understanding, there was one person who had originally agreed to be in the book who decided that he didn't want to be in the book, and decided not only was he not to be in the book, that if I ever mentioned if I mentioned anything about him in any of the other stories, he would sue me and my publisher. And I was like, you didn't actually have to threaten me, you just had to say, hey, I don't want to be in the book. So that was the only thing that I actually got in trouble for over it, and that was one of those things of like, maybe I'm glad I didn't put this person in the book, because apparently he was going to flip out about it. But other than that, there haven't been any pickets, and I'm really upset about that. So hopefully soon it'll show up on like a right wing Christian site. Like, this is the worst thing that anyone has ever done.
Let's hope.
Yeah, yeah. Seriously.
Usually in my books, the people that I portray, I'm just saying that they're sexy and talented, so they don't object. I sometimes get into preemptive trouble if I'm meeting somebody for the first time and showing them my work, and they say, if I date you, will I be in your comic? I'm like, yeah, instant fame. You don't even have to do very much. And sometimes at the club, Lexington Club, if I was to draw people, I usually do the writing right there. And sometimes they look over and tell me to cross out parts, which I'll do.
I don't think I've ever really gotten into troubles for my comics. Sometimes I work with references of friends that I take pictures of them, because sometimes it's easier for me to draw from a photo if it's a complicated pose or something. so people can complain that they look ugly or they don't look like themselves. And I'm trying to explain, you're not supposed to look like yourself because it's not you. My recent comics has some political issues in it. It's not really political, but when you talk about the Israeli army and Palestine, there's always political issues that comes up. So sometimes I find myself arguing with people about it. Mostly they don't expect me to agree with them, and then they find out that we usually agree, and then they kind of figure it out. That's pretty much it. But my sister is also a writer, and one time she asked me about if I feel really comfortable to expose myself in the way I do in my work, because I talk about personal issues, about coming out in a late age, talking about late bloomers, and this is something that she usually don't do, like talking about herself in that way. So this is also something people ask me about, if I feel comfortable with it, but I don't think it's considered as troubles. So yeah.
It's kind of weird when you were talking about that, I was thinking it's kind of weird when you meet people and they've read your work and you're like, oh yeah, you've seen me naked on the
floor. No, never naked, but you know.
In other situations.
Maybe more emotional. It's the nakedness.
When I wrote my book, my mom's sisters were quite angry with me, but they are more the type that are angry silently, so I never had to deal with it. And I thought that
you just feel it.
Yeah, I just caught glimpses of it, and I thought my sister would be mad at me because I tried to be really fair to everybody in my book. Like, the book is about coping with 6 years of my mom dying of Alzheimer's, and we all acted like complete jerks for, various points in time. And so I tried to not show anybody else as being any worse than me. But there were some parts with my sister that I thought were quite, maybe not complimentary. Like, she's very obsessed with her weight, and she would always ask me whether she was fatter than the last time I saw her, which, she's not fat, and, including in the middle of crisis. So, but she didn't mind. So I think it was kind of like she was glad that she was in a comic book and,
Well, I struggled a lot with depicting people in my life in my book, and I did actually send out early drafts to people that I thought were fairly recognizable or central to see whether they objected to anything in particular that they thought was too much exposure for them. And I got a couple of critiques back, but nobody said no. Probably the person that was most difficult was my partner, because she's very central to the book, and she's also not at all the type to self-expose, and I think that it was quite mortifying for her at times, particularly since I was serializing Pregnant Butch. It's not as though she could sit down with the whole thing and say, get rid of this part. Every week I would be posting something. And often I really didn't have time at the time to run in everything by. And also she knew I was on a horrible deadline to get things up. And if she really objected to something, it was going to be terrible for my deadline, and that was going to impact our whole family life. But she generally kept a pretty hands-off policy, though there was one time where I posted a sex scene, a big splash panel, and she said to me, "You do know that my colleagues are reading this." So I made sure she looked really good.
Well, for those of you that didn't specifically go into it, I wonder for yourself, what are the ethics? Do you have an ethical philosophy that you bring to your work? I mean, are there certain things you will or will not write about yourself or other people? Or, you know, do you have a standard protocol of how you deal with it? Like, over the years, I have started obscuring people I date so much now that mostly I'll only draw them as animals with a different name. Because, you know, in Invincible Summer, which was also serialized and it seemed like no big deal, you know, I started dating this girl and I was like, "What do you want your fake name to be?" Because I let everyone choose, even though I would draw them as themselves. I was like, "This is such a photorealistic thing that everyone's going to recognize you," which is actually not true. It's just up here. We think that they look a lot like them. But she was like, "Don't change my name because I'm so good that, like, you don't even need to worry about it. I'm always going to be awesome." And so I kept her name in the self-published ones. But then when someone wanted to collect Invincible Summer as a book, I was like, "You know what? This is like, you're doing some kind of self-harm here by letting me use your real name because actually you turned out to be such a villain. So I'm going to go through on your behalf and change your name in this." And then she appeared in Calling Dr. Laura also as a villain. And so I was like, "I'm going to change your name, even though it still looks like you." But also in Calling Dr. Laura, there were two girls who were such assholes to me. And I thought, I don't want to make this book a slam book. I'm not here to tear anyone down. So I'm going to make them into a composite character that has a couple, you know, different, and we can talk about composite characters later, but I was like, "I'm going to, you know, give this character some of your traits, and they're still doing the same thing you guys did, but it's obscured enough that it's not me just being like, look, I have a publisher, and I'm going to tell everyone what a jerk you were to me." You know, so now I go as far as I can to obscure people so that I can keep the focus on myself, keep the story about myself, and just get the emotional truth of what those people were, what they did. Also, I work with senior citizens, and I do oral histories and comics about them. And so I have to be very careful because they have dementia and things like that where they'll say a lot of things that are hilarious, but maybe, you know, what is the ethical line between, like, grandma's being so kooky? I mean, like, well, she doesn't really, you know, she doesn't see it that way. This is not meant to be slapstick for the people that do not have dementia. This is, you know, I need to somehow protect them, but still convey the levity of the situation. So anyway, I wonder how other people, how you approach your work, if you have an ethical philosophy or a standard that you go by.
I specifically decided not to put myself in this book, actually, because everyone else was anonymous, because everyone else's appearance was being altered so that they wouldn't be recognizable, I would be the only person that would be, you know, okay, that's Dylan, and this must be Dylan's parents, and this must be Dylan's brother. And I felt that was unfair to the people in my life to be the only ones who had to be findable, as opposed to everyone else who got to be anonymous. So I chose not to put myself in there. And also, like, I mean, when I was transitioning, I had some difficulties with various family members, but that would have been a whole different story, and it would have been, like, I didn't actually feel like that was something that I wanted to expose, you know, like, because it was like, we've worked our stuff out, and that would be a long story to tell, and it's not really one that I feel super, like, telling. If I'm going to do autobio stuff, I usually do stuff that's just really laser-focused on myself and not about so much other people around. And as far as, you know, everyone who I interviewed in the story has other people in their lives that were coming in and out. Some interactions were good, some interactions were bad. I tried not to have any villain characters. I figured that the stories that they told me didn't generally go into the territory of, like, let me tell you about my awful ex who was the worst person in the entire world, and I want you to shit all over them in public. It was mostly, like, they were being very honest with themselves about, like, you know, this person, we had an awkward relationship, and these things were good and these things were bad. And so I tried to present that as humanly as possible rather than as, you know, like, here's obviously like the person with the pitchfork and the horns or whatever. And again, because it was all anonymized, I felt a little bit of freedom around, like I didn't necessarily have to go interview, like I'm going to go look up your ex from 10 years ago and interview them in a journalistic fashion to get their side of the story about your, you know, again, it's like, it's about the person's transition and not necessarily so much about, their relationship with their ex or whatever. So, and there were some third party characters that I kind of composited too. So it's like, okay, this person and this person don't really, for the sake of narrative, need to be separate people. You know, they can function as a unit. And so I did that with a few things where it's like, that also kind of helps anonymize people who don't really necessarily need to be like, wait, what is this book and why am I in here? You know? So.
Great.
I changed people's names, except for the one about the bar. People really want them to be like, this was me, I was here. The ones about my personal life, I change people's names and I give them an appearance that's sort of analogous to them, but different. And I'm actually pretty far along the side of like, I think I own my experiences and things that happened to me. I'm gonna write them down. That being said, the reason that I write mostly about myself is that I think that, well, like, first of all, nonfiction is easier for me because it has its own, like, arc, and I already know what happened. And I think that stories are more interesting the more flawed the protagonist is, and I am more comfortable exposing my own flaws than the flaws of other people. So, like, ethically and philosophically, I'm pretty, like, Julia Wirtz once said, like, if you didn't want me to write it, then you should have treated me better. And that's actually what I believe. But in practice, I haven't ever written anything that somebody would object to.
I also change names and faces, the people I write about. I remember I had this discussion once with my boyfriend that eventually the stories are mine. The fact that there is somebody else in there maybe makes them theirs too, but as long as I don't hurt someone purposely, and I'll do everything to avoid unwanted exposure from their side, I think it's something I do. I remember in my current work, there is this story that about this one first date that I had about this guy that on OkCupid was this really handsome person, 34 years old, architect from the Upper West Side, who turned out to be much older. The photo wasn't really his. The Upper West Side was 160th Street, and he was a waiter and an actor. And I remember that we met in a bar, and I was like, didn't you think I'll notice that it's not you and that you're older and that nothing you said about yourself was real? So I put that in my story. And of course, I changed his face and I changed his name. If he will read it, you probably know that I talk about him, because that was really a weird night for me. Because who the hell are you? So I did write about him, and I write about other guys that I dated. They would recognize themselves, but I don't think anyone else would recognize them. Mm-hmm. I also talking about like stories from the army about a friend who died in the army. I also didn't use his name. I think that, you know, out of respect for him, for his family, for other people who knew him, I chose not to use his real name. But again, if someone who knows me will read it, they will know exactly who I'm talking about. So I got your question. I don't think I have a system or a set of ethics that I use. I think each case is different, and just try to do the right thing when you talk about other people.
Yeah. I agree with that, like just trying to think through each situation and actually making a conscious decision as opposed to just kind of putting it out there. I think well, I said before, so I like to just show things as balanced as possible and not, you know, show somebody as evil, like you said. And I think also I've tried to be conscious in my writing about what's my story and what is other people's story. So kind of once it comes somewhat into your world, it is your story, but in what way are you like exposing somebody else in an unfair way? So, yeah.
Right, so of course you're gonna depict other people, but I think you always have to ask yourself, okay, why am I telling this story? Mm-hmm. You know, how does this, is this just an anecdote? Is this something that serves my larger story? You know, this is a memoir, so it is talking about my experience. And how does, you know, taking this person on, or maybe even sharing a story that they've told, how does it, is it justified in the way that it talks about my own story? And it is really hard. It is really hard, especially, you know, you want to be entertaining. And like your demented friends, there's a lot of material out there that I would love to have included and shots that I want to take at people. I still feel some ugginess around some parts of my book, like, would I do that differently if I had it to do all over again? I do a big section in the book about Ina Mae Gaskin, who was a natural childbirth guru. And so when I was pregnant, I read her book because I was interested in natural childbirth. And it was such a mind fuck, this book. I mean, it's written in the 70s originally, and it's a really a portrait of a period of time and a countercultural experience and of hers. But the way that it struck me, and particularly in terms of gender and the very strict gendering roles that Ina Mae assigns in her description of birth and how to do it right, it just pissed me off so much. And I really got very much in a twist about it at the time. And I wanted to talk about that, but it's not a flattering depiction of her. And since then, I met someone who does a radio show here in New York, who actually, after she had a bad experience reading Ina Mae's book and then having a birth experience that didn't line up with kind of the promises of an ecstatic childbirth that were possible according to Ina Mae, she actually called up Ina Mae and invited her on the show, and they had a whole conversation about it. And I was really impressed with just, you know, the courage of a journalistic approach, as opposed to something that was more like, I'm gonna be critical, but I'm not gonna give the person a chance really to respond. So,
but is that your job as a memoirist?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's not my job, but I have to live with the consequences. And the consequences were that since then I've had second thoughts about it. Mm-hmm. And I've thought, and I've really thought, maybe this is a great argument for fiction. You know, except fiction is really hard to write when you're accustomed to speaking in the first person and telling a story in that mode. So ambivalent memoirs.
I want to know if there are any lessons or tools of fiction that you bring into your work. I think hard about fiction whenever I'm starting a longer thing. I think about story arc. I think about, you know, if you introduce a gun in the first chapter, it has to go off by the last chapter. Because I'm so used to having done years of diary comics where I'm like, all these things happen and they may not connect to anything else. Like, here's a character that I have a crush on this person. You never see what happens. You go, oh, well, sorry, nothing happened by the end of the 2-week period. So I just included that random person for no reason. So now I'm more deliberate about it and I think, okay. Everyone that's in there needs to earn their spot, you know. In a comic, it's prime real estate. It's taking you forever to draw it. Your hand is getting cramped up. If they're in there, they need to be there for a reason. So I think about that. When I was writing, and my mom and my ex-girlfriend seemed to be villains, you know, as the story went on, because the girl was like such a jerk and my mom was not the best. I really sat down, and my editor and I were like, okay. And also, I want to know your editing process. I have an editor now, which is incredible, because as somebody working in a vacuum, my stories were not as strong as they could have been, and now I have somebody to look over it and tell me. She said, okay, if this person is going to fuck up so royally at the end, we need to know why they're in your life. So, you know, there's nobody that you start dating who you meet them, and they're like, I'm a total a-hole. And you're like, great, let's go on a date. It's more like, What are the things that made you fall in love with them, make the reader fall in love with them, and then it's as disappointing for the reader as it is for you. Another thing that I would say I take from fiction writing is, you know, no tears for the writer, no tears for the reader. If you're not feeling something while you're doing it, then why should your reader? So same thing with my mom. It was like, okay, you know, your mom made some really bad choices, but she's still in your life. What are some things that are redeeming about her? So I actually made a list. Here's all the times where my girlfriend's a jerk. Here's all the times my mom is a jerk. I'm going to make as many scenes of them being kind or good or lovable as that, so the reader is invested in them, and then the reader gets to have the bottom fall out from under them, just like I did. So those are some things I take from fiction. So I want to know, do you bring any standard fiction or writing tools to your work, and or what is your editing process? And if it's too much to swallow, we can go back and talk about editing in a second.
So with this book, since it was interviews, I sent each of the participants basically just a questionnaire, like answer these questions, and I didn't give them any particulars on how they should answer. So some people sent me back, you know, long detailed stories and answers to specific questions. Some people just did bullet point answers to each question. And a couple of people were like, well, I don't really feel like filling out the questionnaire, but can we talk on the phone and I'll just tell you some stories? And so I kind of adapted each story to fit their style, because I wanted each person, because it is a real human being behind each of these stories, I wanted that person to show through. I didn't want my voice to drown out their voice, so I didn't want to write them. I wanted to just kind of tease the narrative out of what they told me. So I built them, like I took the actual pieces of dialogue that they gave me and turn that into the word balloons of, like, you know, these are to keep the voice consistent. And so I did kind of look for stuff like that. Like, is there a story they told me where there's a beginning, middle, and end that I can turn into a narrative? Or if they did kind of a bullet point list of answers to these questions, you know, how does that reflect in their personality? How can I build a narrative around that? So one of the stories takes place inside a museum of this person's life, which is obviously a complete fictional fabrication, but it made a lot of sense for their particular character, and you're still getting the truth of their story, but the framing device kind of adds to the personality of the person that I'm talking about. So that is kind of marrying the fiction with the reality. And the editing process on this was originally, it ultimately was published by Northwest Press, but the book was originally with Beacon Press, and when it was with Beacon Press, they did professionally edit it. So I had three editors while I was with them, and that was my first time being edited. I had always just been like, I have an idea, and I'm going to make a comic of it and put it out into the world. And this was a process where I would take the interview, turn it into a script, show the editor the script, get feedback on the script, send the script to the person whose story I was telling, get feedback on that, then thumbnail the chapter and send it to the editor, get feedback, you know, rewrite, send it, you know, and then... So it went back and forth between editors and the people that the story was about, like, bouncing around before it ever got to pencils.
Mm-hmm.
And pencil the chapter and then send it out to the editor and get feedback. By the pencil portion of the process, it was pretty much set. Like, at that point, the only edits I were getting back were things like, well, in this panel, this person is supposed to look kind of nervous, but they just look cold, so can you change their facial expression? Mm-hmm. So, but I found the editing process to be extremely helpful to my everything about my process since then. They talking with someone whose job it is to edit is very different from just showing your thing to a friend, because your friend doesn't want to hurt your feelings when they're giving you feedback, so they're going to give you as little feedback as they can. But an editor is going to be like, let me get out my red pen and bleed all over your manuscript, because they want it to be as good as it can possibly be. And they have no emotional investment in staying friends with you. They have an emotional investment in making sure that your book is good.
So they make money.
And I loved my editors. I got really excellent feedback on just structure and narrative and everything. And there was a different comic that I had started before I started working on this, and I put it aside. What to work on transposes, which took 4 years, and then I come back to finish up the other comic I'd started, and it's like, well, my style has really changed a lot, so, and I didn't want to redraw everything, so it's like, how can I have to kind of backtrack my style a little bit to put it in.
Weird.
Yeah, like, just what, for example, one of the things was like, my word balloons were huge and had massive amounts of text in them. The editor is like, can we get this down to, like, maybe maximum of 20 words in a balloon, or whatever, like, three lines of text. If you're going to have more than that, break it out into another balloon, break up your dialogue somehow, but don't have a huge chunk that where you're basically making people read a prose piece inside your comic.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, so it was a very, very enriching process to work with a professional editor.
So to the first question about borrowing from fiction, I started doing that sort of between the first book and the second book. People responded to the first book by wishing me luck on my quest. I was like, what? Quest? And they also responded by either directly to me or through email, giving me a lot of advice about how to find my one true love. And I was like, people are really hoping for me that this happens. So then I read a little bit about in fiction, like, there's a protagonist with, like, a goal or the thing that they want, their motive, and then there's, like, a resolution, do they get that or not? And I'm like, oh, I'm, like, setting up this whole, like, motive thing, and people are like, you're not getting there, let us help you. So, you know, I am trying to now, like, within my stories, even if I don't get what it is that I'm hoping for, keep in mind, like, I'm the protagonist, this is a thing that I want. This is, and like, does it work out or not? Like, tell the reader. And that has helped me to not write stories where I just sort of blunder through an experience until it's over. That's a waste of everybody's time. In terms of editing, I don't have an editor, like a professional editor, but my mother is really great about, like, spell checking and grammar checking and telling me when stuff isn't very good or if it's funny. And in terms of content editing, I mean, before I write a comic, I usually will tell the story verbally to a bunch of friends and see, like, where is it funny? What questions do they have? Do they say, like, and then what happened? Like, then I know maybe to write more. And then my favorite thing is, like, looking over people's shoulders while they're reading the comic. Are you going to laugh at the laugh line? So that is my informal process of editing.
I guess my process would be, I usually just write the story first, just the story. Then I try to make a script out of it, 10 sketches and pencils, and then it becomes a comic page. I think a challenge that I have in the current book, and I also had it in my first book, which was about my father's childhood stories from Eastern Europe, is that this cuts between the past and present days. On my first book, some of the critiques that I got were that it's confusing, and the readers were sometimes confused between the past and the present. So in this book, I try to find ways to make it very clear that we're in you know, my childhood during the 80s in Israel, and now we're back in Brooklyn. So I try to use a different color for the text balloons and a different palette for the colors. And I think it works better now. I agree with you. It's when you see someone read the comics and you really want them to get it.
Yeah.
Sometimes they try to give you compliments about something you didn't try to do or didn't try to convey. He didn't get it at all. again, I have these tools that I use, palettes, text, and the context itself. Sometimes I use a lot of captions sometimes, and I try to like there's someone who tells the story. It was 1983, I was doing this and that. I think each project is a different kind of challenge and I use different editing tools. I always give everything for, you know, my close friends, my boyfriends, my sister, try to make the story better, and make sure that whatever I have in my head, I can actually convey to other people, because something that sometimes I think is very clear and obvious for other people would be like, what are you talking about?
That's the hardest thing, because when you know the story, you're like, oh yeah, obviously my teddy bear is named after my stepdad from when I was four. Duh. And then readers went, why is that bear named Ramondo? And you're like, well,
exactly. Exactly.
Yeah, I agree. I teach comics as well, and it's something that I'm writing, and it comes up all the time when people are writing about their personal stories, and it comes as such a surprise that other people don't know the backstory. And, you know, you have to, and for me, I wrote this story about my mom and our family, and I had other people in my life reading it and giving me some feedback, but then once I sold it and I was working with the editor and the publisher, it was a really useful and intense experience that really helped the book, because she was able to say, you know, so your dad's doing this now, but I have no idea why that's important, because I don't know what he used to do. And the big, you know, the central thing in the story was my mom having Alzheimer's and really changing as a person. But the biggest thing I had to change and add to my manuscript after I sold it was showing people more of what she used to be like before she got sick, because because you are like, well, of course it's devastating that my mom got sick, because she used to be this woman who was blah, blah, blah. But if you don't show everybody else, then it doesn't make any sense.
And were there any ideas from fiction or, you know, kind of tropes or narrative structures that you put into this work?
I tried to give myself a bit more of a journey as a character. Like, I knew, for me, one of the main things when my mom got sick was that, you know, I was in my late 20s, but I was still very much related to her as a kid, and that I had to grow up a lot and start taking care of myself and acting more like an adult and not calling her in the middle of the night to cry about my girlfriend or, you know, whatever I was doing at the time. So I tried to show more of that journey, and just the journey of other people in my family as well, from kind of flailing around and wondering what we were going to do to having some sort of concept of how to cope with them. So, yeah, but it was hard, and you know, I'd just been writing these diary entries and making sketches for 6 years, just like by myself, right, and not showing them to anybody. So,
yeah, I really concur with that. The need for to go from a chronological and and sort of diary based. Group of stories into something that actually conveys that there was a lot of internal growth that happened, and that's hard to show, especially since some of the internal growth happened after the process. Like in my case, I feel like a lot of it happened in becoming a parent, and yet I'm taking it back and showing that actually happening during pregnancy. So that was sort of a necessary fiction structure need that I paid attention to. I didn't work with an editor. I had a really small press. And by the time I sold it, they just wanted to get it out there. And I had just copy editing done from the press and no real back and forth with a professional editor. Of course, that said, I have a publishing background. That's my money job, is that I do graphics production. And so I know a lot of editors. And I worked with a writing group when I was making the story, and we presented to each other. Everybody did once a month, and so I did this for about a year with my group of five people. And everyone was very serious. It was not just a group of friends. And it's a kind of a nice in-between, especially if you don't have an editor that's being paid to do it for you. If you work with a writer's group, everybody had once a month where they put out their latest chapter, what have you, and they came back covered in red. And so so a lot of problems with, I don't understand what just happened there, or why are you showing yourself that way there? I don't get it. A lot of those things got flushed out through that process, and those were the things that I felt were really invaluable to me.
My editing process for Calling Dr. Laura was a true nightmare. Well, first, and this is what I do for any story like this, I took a friend to coffee. I was like, can I buy you coffee? And then I just told her the whole story. And I was like, does this seem like anything? Because it feels boring to me. Because after telling the same story several times about your own life, you're like, who cares? Like this dog book I'm working on, I'm like, I had a dog, she died, who cares? And then, so to get myself back on track, I'd call a friend on the phone. I'm like, can I just tell you this story? And you just tell me if anything sticks out to you as interesting or you want to know more about, or is this even worth my time? And so then I explained the whole story. She's like, yeah, duh. Like it's more than I had a dog, then she was bad, then she died, the end. Which would be a short book. But with Calling Dr. Laura, I thumbnailed it. So very quick sketches where I just got the idea down. I got like the facial gesture, the facial expressions, the gestures, the scene, the setting down. And then I penciled it. And I actually had a different publisher at first who had never done a graphic memoir before, a graphic novel before. So they said, just work on your own, be free, and then we'll see you in 2 years. Just do the book. We trust you. And I was like, this is great. So I worked on the book by myself. Friends who were making comics for more professional comics publishers were having to turn in all their pencils, like you were, along the way. And I was like, well, I guess I'm just a little bit better of a writer than you. Because my editor trusts me. I can just go straight to ink. And then I turned in the book, and it was a big nightmare. My editor was like, I have zero edits for you. And I was like, oh, I really knocked this out of the park. Like, I really am as good of a writer as I thought I was. And then the publisher was like, oh, just kidding. We need you to redo the whole book because we want to publish it at a different proportion than how you drew it. So I drew it like this, big. And then they were like, that's awesome. Can you just do it like as big as Fun Home? Because we really wanted to like sit on the shelf like Fun Home. And I was like, are you out of your fucking minds? So they sent me the proof and it was on 8.5 by 11 paper, if I may use this. Uh-huh. But the pictures were like this big and there were huge white borders on the top and bottom. And one of my friends was like, oh, that's great. It's like American Born Chinese. This other book that has like tiny panel in the middle, huge borders on top and bottom. And I actually asked the author of that book later, Jean Yang, I was like, oh, one of my friends referred me to your book. And he's like, that was also a mistake. That book having those crazy borders like that and the pictures being so small was also a mistake. So I went to a different publisher with the book. I had to leave that publisher, had this time where the book was homeless, found a new home for the book, had a new editor. She was like, this book's great. I have a billion edits for you. The edits took me 9 months. And then she was like, okay, you know, add these pages so we know why this thing is happening, who this person is, why do we care? Explain, why is your teddy bear named after a stepdad? Not normal. Those kinds of things. And I added 50 new pages, and I Frankenstein things around. My editor left, as editors are wont to do. I turned it in. A new editor was like, you know what? I'm just going to take another crack at it. I have 6 more months of editing for you to do. And at this point, I was pretty much putting my head in the oven. I was like, forget it. I had finished it so many times. My friends have bought me drinks like 4 different times. And so now, walking down the streets of Portland, people will be like, how's your bus? Shut up. Like, I don't want to talk about my bus. Like, are you done with your... I'm like, when I'm done, you'll see it. It'll be on the shelf. That's how you know it's done. And they're like, oh, God. So nobody asks me anymore. Yes?
I do want to say, actually, it's interesting you bring up the whole borders thing. Fun Home also is not done for 6x9 format.
Oh.
If you look at the margins on that book, there's a huge fat margin at the bottom of every page because Allison originally did that in the same format that Stuck Rubber Baby was done in.
Oh, yeah.
It's a completely different format. So it's funny, like, I had this similar situation where this was originally supposed to be 6x9 when it was with Beacon, because they were doing the same thing.
My press was Beacon Press.
Oh, my God.
I love their prose. I love their written work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when it went to Northwest Press, Zan was like, we're going to do this in the comic book format, 7x10. So this was, and the book was done at that point. So I was like, okay, well, and it worked out okay. Like, there's no weird margins, although I did the type on computer rather than hand lettering. So sometimes the word balloons don't quite fit the type anymore because the font size changed on me. But it is funny that, like, Fun Home also not done in the format that it was published in.
Everyone, be explicit with anyone you're working with about the size. Even my book proposal was in that size, but somehow they just like spaced it. And then, yeah, make sure it was explicit. So I basically ended up doing 1.5 years of edits and it sucked. The end. A question I have for everyone is, how do you separate yourself from your character? Or do you? Because I just went to a panel at Mocha where Aileen Kaminsky-Crum, you know, someone from the audience said, or she said, you know, people come to me all the time and they say, I know you. And she says, no, you don't. Mm. People feel like they know you from reading your work, but they don't actually know you. Or do you feel like they do? I feel like they don't. I feel like people are looking over the idea that this is an edited piece of work. You know, Howden Mifflin didn't come to my house, rifle through my journals, and then find something to publish. I specifically made decisions about how I was going to portray myself, how I was going to portray my actions, the people around me. So I wonder, as someone who struggles with that, how do you separate yourself from your character if you do? If you do, you know, memoir, diary kind of things.
I think that when I'm writing a comic, I'm doing, like, I'm usually, for autobio stuff, I'm going for overall something that's going to make people laugh. So that's definitely a crafted narrative. That's not like, you know, exactly the same thing as sitting down and having a chat. And I would say, like, you know, if you read this book, you're not going to necessarily, like, if you happen to know who a person is in here, you're not just going to be like, oh my God, that's, now I'm best friends with so-and-so. But it does, like, it does, it is a little weird. Like, people do kind of feel like they do end up knowing things about you that, and you don't know what they actually know.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, a convention or something, having a conversation with, you know, a random person who's buying stuff, and they'll drop some fact about your life in there, and it's like, oh, I guess you know that because I did put a comic out on the web that had that information in there, but now we're talking about it like I told you that story in person, and it's not really that. And I don't know. I mean, I don't necessarily want to... I mean, if people are reading your comic, I don't want to be like...
Stop reading my comic.
Stop reading my comic. Stop talking to me
They're
about
private.
Stuff that I wrote. Right. I mean, just because it's on the internet, God, but... But it's a little weird because, you know... Because you didn't get that back from them. You didn't say, here, you know, it wasn't like you were sitting down having a conversation and then they were like, oh, well, here's the funny thing that happened to me, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I do feel like you're kind of getting the fictionalized version of somebody out of that.
Mm-hmm.
You're getting whatever window they want to show you, but you're not getting, you know, and then I went to the grocery store, unless you did a comic about going to the grocery store.
Can I ask, since the book we're talking about for you is a little different, if this has impacted the people who did it, how it's impacted the people who gave you their stories? I mean, I know that you anonymize them so much, but does it?
So it really depends on the person, because some of them were very much like, you know, if I'm drawing them in their apartment, they're like, well, don't use that poster because that's in my actual apartment. You know, use some other poster that I'll give you a list of, you know, posters you can actually, like, very, very much like kind of, and I gave them this opportunity. It wasn't annoying to me, but so I think for people like that, they were happy to have the story out there for other people to read and get something out of, but they really wanted to be able to step away from it.
Mm-hmm.
There were a couple of other people in there who were like, you know, I would say, hey, what do you want your character to look like? And, you know, they'd be just like, well, just draw me like I look. I mean, I'm basically out to everybody all the time anyway. And, you know, they might not talk about it in public, but they would definitely say to their friends, hey, I'm in this book. One of the guys in the book is very out, very much, you know, like I still gave him a fake name for the book in case he ever decided he wanted to back out of that kind of public life. But his statement when I was saying, hey, how do you want to look? He's like, just make me look like me so that when I go try to get laid by saying, hey, I'm in this comic, I can point to myself and be like, oh, you are in this comic.
It's so big, he's gonna have to have a knapsack with them all the time.
Right. So he's very happy to be like, here I am, and I don't know if he had anyone be like, well, yes, I will have sex with
well,
you.
Well, that's not how good.
So but hopefully that, but I think that does, like, it does change how people even just within their own, whatever sphere of their lives, maybe not in public, they're like, you're the guy in the comic. But more like, you know, hey, I'm in this comic. How does that, you know, how does that change the narrative that they have with individuals in their lives?
First of all, I forgot something about editing that I'm just going to throw out there. Working on a grid is really helpful because I have a 9x9 grid that I take with me everywhere since like a year and a half ago. And then if you need to switch a panel, it's easy. And then when I do the comics that are more, the pages are swoopy doopy and integrated and beautiful. Edit, if you have one edit, you have to redo the whole page. That's like just something that I wanted to share. In terms of myself, I think my comics would be better if I made myself more of a character outside myself. For instance, like, at different times in my life, I've looked really different. Like, I was thinner, long blonde hair, different things. And what I'm drawing from that time, I always draw what I looked like then. And people say, like, is this all about character? And I'm like, yes, yes. But on the other hand, I think people treated me differently when I look different ways, so I tend to keep it the way that it is. And usually I think the opposite reaction is you have saying, like, you don't really know me. It's like, oh, shit, you know me way better than than I anticipated. You read all my comics, and I would have told you this 3 months from now, but actually I told you before. And so that's an interesting new thing. And I wrote a note, what else?
How does it impact things though? Like if you're meeting somebody, you're getting to know them, they're like, oh, I know, all the stuff that you would have waited a while to tell me, does that mean that you, do you speed up the knowing process? You're like, well, then let me tell you about this time I got my period, or like, or do you kind of say like, well, let's put that on a shelf and talk about it later, or?
The time that it was the most relevant, I was seeing somebody for a few months, and I guess he just kept bringing it up, like, we were on a date where, like, I went to his house and cooked dinner, and he was on the couch, and he was like, this is just like that comic that you wrote about a date that didn't really happen, but you wrote it as though it happened and then told the audience that it hadn't really happened. And I was like, that's because this is my fantasy. And it makes me feel a little bit self-aware, but it also makes me feel more comfortable with that person, knowing that, like, whatever it is, like, they've already bought into a lot of me. Mm-hmm. I feel sometimes like I'm at the slight underhand. I'm like, now I'm going to ask you something really personal because you know so many personal things about me. But that doesn't always work out. I usually have to be patient. And the other thing is that because I try to be so critical of myself because I like flaws, people are getting like me, but maybe like a little bit less cool. Like people keep saying to me, like, you're like the nerd hero or you're such an anti-hero. And I'm like, I'm cool.
It's good to undersell yourself, so when they meet you, they'll be
pleasantly
like,
surprised.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah.
That's smart. It's a great tactic. I like you're getting buy-in. People are, you're getting some buy-in from your dates. You're buying into your whole thing. Uh-huh. Then you're meeting people, you're exceeding their expectations.
I make myself better looking, but like more self-deprecating. So
do you
I
give,
can come with
do you give them like a questionnaire? Like you need to be able to answer these questions about me to make sure that you read my comics?
No, I don't. Like, I keep forgetting that they've read it, and then they say, like, I remember this detail, or they say, I don't actually date that many people. Like, there were, like, six people that I wrote about, and then I was, like, seeing the seventh person, and after, like, a six-year relationship, and person number seven was like, am I being like person number two right now? I'm like, don't worry about it. Don't worry about
more
it.
More like a four. I don't think I necessarily separate myself from my character, but I think these kind of projects are like, kind of like scripted documentary where I'm the writer and the director, so I choose what I want to tell. So by reading the book or the graphic novel, someone knows exactly what I want them to know. So I don't think necessarily that someone that reads the book can really come and say, I know you. He knows part of me, the part that I chose to share. I think that's pretty much sums it up in a way when you work on a autobiographical piece, that, and it's something that all artists do. You always expose yourself in a way. But I don't believe that unless you want to, you put yourself entirely out there for people to see. I never had this kind of incident when someone challenged me about my book, asked me is it me in there? I know what you're gonna say right now because this is what you write in your books. Because again, it's scripted. As you're talking about being cool.
Yeah.
So like, I'm the coolest dude in my books because I can actually sit down and write exactly what I would have said. Exactly like if I knew about this question, I would have had a really cool answer.
In the comic, you're going to be a...
Yeah, so you know, if I'm going to make a comic about this panel, I'm going to have this really amazing answer that will blow your mind. Like this one.
Jaws are dropping.
Yeah.
Everyone gives you a standing ovation.
So profound.
Yeah, the rest of us are just sitting there with little question marks.
I just have a tear going down my face. That was so profound.
Yeah.
Just not like that. But this is all I have.
Wow. Yeah, I think I'm pretty similar to how I portray myself. But I do have that experience of like writing all these really revealing things and then publishing it and then somehow forgetting. So when somebody will bring it up, I'm like, oh, right, because you actually saw me having sex. And it's weird, like, as a teacher sometimes, where my students have read the book and I'm like, you know, there's only one sex scene, I think, but there's also scenes like partway in my mom's illness, like she was having trouble sitting on the toilet. So we got this really big seat that goes on top of the toilet. But I'm a lot shorter than my mom. So when I sat on the toilet seat, like my feet went towards the ground and I would always pee on the toilet seat. And there's just this like picture of me sitting naked on the toilet seat. And I just got so used to talking about the book in public. And I remember being doing this presentation and then realizing that I'm sitting there beside this huge picture of myself naked on the toilet, and then there was part of me that was just absolutely not okay with that, but there I was.
You were like, who wrote this?
Yeah, I know.
Who's done this bullshit?
And then I just a couple of years ago I wrote this whole history of my menstrual cycle, well, my menstrual history leading up to a hysterectomy. And anyway, there's like lots of blood and there's lots of like, you know, blood stains on clothing and lots of information. And that's where, like, when I know that my students have read that, I'm kind of, but then I did it, so what's my problem?
Does it make you more vulnerable to your students in some way? Because like other teachers get to be like, there's professional boundary. You don't know anything about me. I'm mysterious. I'm just knowledgeable. That's all you know. And then you're like, my students know I have a period. They know I've had sex. I definitely use the toilet. In some ways, I feel that way. Like, I don't care telling a bunch of strangers, like, oh, I got my heart broken. But students, I'm like, none of your business.
Yeah, really. I think it's okay, mostly because I teach in a creative writing department, so I'm not the only one. But yeah, it's just this weird thing where you've done something, like I've put all this stuff out there intentionally, and then I'm somehow shocked that other people actually absorb the information.
Do you feel like there has to be a disconnect for you to put it out?
Yeah.
I feel that way.
Yeah, like you can't, yeah. So in a way, like I guess I said, I feel like I'm similar to how I portray myself, but of course, in ways not, right? Like you have to make yourself into this character and not show certain parts of yourself.
Well, I was having such a hard time distinguishing between myself and what I was putting down in the comic that I took the measure of giving myself another name. So in the book I call myself T, which really just stands for TK. Which, you know, those of you from publishing know means to come. It made it a lot easier to turn myself into a character rather and have some dissociation there. I do have people comment on things that are in the book that I forget about now and then, like there's a big wide open beaver shot that's been brought up to me a number of times. And mostly I think I deal with it by forgetting that it's in there. And I have been grilled by some people about things that they want to know that are sort of parts of them are in the book, and then there are things that are not included in the book that they ask about. Well, did this mean that? And because I don't have great boundaries or filters, I find myself usually answering honestly before I have a chance to stop myself. But I like to think I'm getting better.
I'm working on that.
Yeah.
On the idea that you don't have to tell people everything they ask
you. I put the thing down that I thought I wanted to say that was important to me for the story, and that should be good enough.
It is interesting, because then people at some point sometimes feel like they are owed
they're like, well, then you have no privacy. Like, mm-hmm. you gave up a little bit of privacy, so maybe that means everything is fair game. They're like, can I see your beaver now? I saw a drawing of it. You're like, no. They're like, can I ask you some questions about that? You're like, well, no, that's not appropriate. They're like, well, you drew it. Anyway.
Yeah.
I want to open this up. Oh, I do want to say I love the idea of bringing up disassociation, because I was at something and somebody asked Michelle T, you know, how do you write so many personal details and then walk around being alive, knowing that people are reading about your sex life? And she's like, I think I just disassociate a lot. And I really concurred with that. I was like, you know, I think you have to have a little bit of that to be able to do what we do, to draw a picture of yourself naked, put it out there. I would never put a photo of myself naked anywhere, but, you know, I would draw it and then... I actually wouldn't draw because I'm too much of a prude, but I would, you know, write lots of personal things, and I just pretend like they don't exist, or just live life now, not thinking about that. Anyway, I want to open it up for Q&A, for you to ask our illustrious panelists some questions. So if anyone has a question, now is the great time for that.
For Kate, so your kid shows up right at the end.
Yeah.
And I know that the story was about you being pregnant, so that makes sense that your kid only shows up right at the end. But I just thought that was, I just wondered if it was also a choice around privacy.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a nightmare vision as I was doing it. Like, what is he gonna think? You know, when this comes out, is he going to be embarrassed? Is this going to be stuff that other kids tease him about? I just really tried to really minimize when and where he's shown in the book. But then at the end, I didn't. So the publisher asked me to do an epilogue, since it was coming out for, I mean, he'll be 12 this summer. So... this is all stuff that happened a long time ago. At the time that I was working with the publisher, it was 10 years. And they asked for an epilogue, and I asked him, my son that is, you know, would you mind if I just showed a little bit of you as a kid? Because I figured also, as a kid, he has some more control over his self-presentation. He was old enough to seem like a human being that wasn't just a toddler running around in a diaper or something like that. And he was way into it, you know. And of course I respected his wishes about how he wanted to be depicted.
We probably got him just at the right time.
Right.
He's 12, because if you'd asked him when he was 14, he'd be like, fuck off.
Yeah. Draw yourself. Or knowing him, he probably would have wanted to submit the art for his own.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question for Sara. So you mentioned that you like to get a chance to talk about the queer side to your comics, because primarily this comic is about Alzheimer's disease. Do you find that you tend, because it is about mental health and Alzheimer's disease, that you attract an audience that might not necessarily be comfortable with your queerness, and that you get some different reactions to that because of it?
I'm not sure. I think overall the response has been really positive, and it's made me feel really, really good. Like I even though some of the readers are, like, my mom was very young when she got Alzheimer's, so she was like in her early 50s, and she died when she was 60. And so the book is not so much about old people, and I also really wanted it to be, anyway, okay, sorry, that was a different tangent. But so yeah, overall people have been, I think it's a positive thing, and then they're like, oh, she's a lesbian. Or maybe they're like, my girlfriend looks so much like a boy that maybe some, anyway, no, but she's naked. Anyway, and there's a whole thing in there about me being a lesbian. So yeah, I think overall it's a positive thing where people are connected with the story, and so maybe if they're not as informed about queer issues or even homophobic, then they get over it. But then I think sometimes it's that people are just kind of like, okay, let's not talk about that part of the book. Let's focus on your relationship with your mom. And in most reviews and interviews and stuff, it's rare that my relationship or that my sexuality is mentioned. So I feel like sometimes that's like a double-edged thing. Like it's I think it reflects a level of tolerance and acceptance, and then sometimes I think it's like people just aren't interested in that part of the book.
Does it ever make you want to go out and draw comics that are more explicitly about the queer parts of your life? Because, you know, so
yeah.
Your comics career has been about.
Yeah, I'm kind of working. I've been gathering and collecting images for a comic about my partner, which will definitely be more explicitly queer. The first version of the book that I did had way more in it about my partner and my relationship, because we got together at the same time that my mom was getting sick. So it was this whole kind of parallel journey, but I really, that, like, I, when I first, the first publisher who rejected it was like, this is just, like, you, it's too much. There's too much going on here. And I think maybe in somebody else might have been able to do it, but it was too much to keep all those strands together. Plus, I had another, it was going to be a braided story about, like, my mom being ill and me falling in love. And then my mom's name is Miriam, so I had this whole stream about Miriam in the Bible. And which was really cool, but it didn't really work. So, yeah. But there are some chapters, like there's a chapter, I do write in there about like just kind of some of the weirdnesses of doing personal care for my mom. I have discomfort with it because of being a lesbian. There was often like this thought in the back of my head, like, what if somebody thinks that it's inappropriate for me to do personal care for my mom? Even though I don't even think that's realistic, I feel like it was part of my internalized homophobia. And then there was this whole incident that happened where I was walking down the street holding my mom's hand and these teenage boys started calling us dykes. And so there is definitely queer stuff in the book. But yeah, I would sometimes, especially when I'm in queer situations like this, I'm like, oh, I wish I was doing more queer stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. I was hoping to expand that question maybe to AK and some of the other panelists as well. Like, have you gotten any feedback from people saying that your story has helped sort of build empathy across communication barriers? Like, I was able to point to Pregnant Bush as something to, like, members of my family that I could sort of say, like, this is, like, sort of really a story of something that a lot of people in my community are going through and trying to, like, build family. And that, you know, my family, you know, in other parts of the country weren't exposed to that before, really. So it was like, oh, this is a good thing. So, and maybe, you know, if anyone else wants to speak to that as well, but do you think there's opportunity for the memoir form specifically to build empathy across those communication barriers?
Absolutely. I mean, it's really been a bridge book for a lot of people. You know, my mother and all her friends.
Yeah.
And, you know, and tons of straight people encounter it and find something to, you know, that relates to them. You know, they're like, oh, I can see myself in here, and now I understand a little bit more about butches. You know, and so... and also, I really had a straight audience in mind for a lot of the writing of it, because I felt, I mean, my reason for wanting to do the thing in the first place was, I'm tired of having these conversations with people in playgrounds about our pregnancies, where the weirdness of mine or the, you know, the disjuncture parts of mine are very hard to talk about in just that shooting the shit kind of way with the general audience that you find in a playground. And it needs a little more attention to get it across. And I do think that the memoir form is easier for general audiences to swallow. and like to expose themselves to something they don't know anything about. You know, it's just like the individual is less threatening. If it's a first-person account, people find it harder to be put off.
It's also, I think, harder for them to discount. Like, if it's a fictionalized narrative, they'll be like, oh, sure, whatever. Yeah. But if it's like, this is a person's life, then they're more like, wait, this happened?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, I have definitely had the experience of people, like, I had written this with the audience in mind of trans people who wanted stories that they could relate to. And I certainly have had a lot of feedback from people who were like, oh my God, I saw myself in here. And secondarily, also with cis gay men in mind, because they are at some point probably not realizing that they're going to go out on a date with a trans guy. And it may happen, and it'd be like, you now already know about trans guys, and you don't have to be like, what? Tell me your life story. And I've had a lot of cis gay guys be like, yeah, this actually really kind of opened my eyes to what trans guys are all about, and I think kind of took some of the awkward mystery out of it. The group that surprised me the most actually are cis straight men. I've had a lot of cis straight men approach me and be like, I really got a lot out of this. And like, really? You followed everything in there? Because I was not writing this for people who, I was not writing for Trans 101. I was writing for people who at least already had some grounding in that. But, you know, I think this is something that one of my editors kept going on about is like, trust your reader, don't insult their intelligence, and just, you know, don't feel like you have to explain everything to them. If they don't understand something, we have the internet and they can look it up. And by putting it in this very humanized narrative, I think that does a lot of the work of pulling people along, and they'll understand it a lot more, I think, than you even are expecting.
I found less that the book is like crossing a border, and more, I mean, I also don't have a publisher, so I'm like literally distributing things either at conventions or local stores or my website, but the emails that I get from people who say things like that are, it's more like, I saw myself in your book and it was validating, and then I showed it to my friends type of a thing. And I mean, I had, when I was starting to make them, I had some question about like, do I really want to define myself as bisexual before any of my other traits? And normally the answer is no. Like, me personally, that's not how I feel. But I was like, I'm just going to put this huge letters across the top because I want for people to be able to see if they're scanning, like, this book is for me or about people like me.
I agree that the form of memoir or autobiographical work, it's more approachable and it's easier for people to learn from it and to connect to it. I think the personal story of a pregnant butch and or I can tell that for me is a gay soldier was something that, you know, people read that, and this is not something that they usually expect. This is not the stereotype. And when someone reads it and like, this is my story, this is happening. And there are a lot of gay people in the army. A lot of lesbian women have children. We're not all, you know, lumberjacks and dancing to Lady Gaga and, you know, in industry or therapy. So I think this form helped to break barriers and change perceptions and stereotypes. So yeah, I would agree with what you feel about that.
It's always the secret agenda of all my work is to have people feel like they know a gay person. And then maybe they'll think about that gay person they feel like they know when they have the chance to vote or speak behind our backs. to other people about things that could affect our lives. So it's kind of like the plus and minus of people feeling like they know you without knowing you is, I feel fine sacrificing my cartoon self to be like, yes, you know me very well, we're great friends. Mm-hmm. Now, when you're voting on gay marriage, or, you know, yeah. when a bunch of straight people are saying something weird about queers, you can think like, oh, I feel like I know a queer person, and then, you know, have that inform your experience. Mm-hmm. Questions?
Okay, so you guys talked about like how you use some like fiction devices in your work, but I'm really curious because I'm doing memoir too, but not, and I'm just curious about actually adding in fiction, like your thoughts mm-hmm. about adding in fiction when, like not just as a like to build a narrative, but or even. Thoughts around that, like, but also just to fill in the gap sometimes, or you know, to distance yourself, or like, just the thoughts about. I know there's like a whole like debate about this, like, is it memoir? But what do you think? Like, if you kind of work with memory slippage, or like, do you acknowledge that you forgot? Like, what kinds of strategies do you use to deal with? Having maybe forgotten some details, or know that there are a couple of versions of something that happened.
Well, are you familiar with work of Mari Naomi? She does she does a lot of memoir work. But her take on it is that there's a difference between memoir and biography. Mm-hmm. So biography, you're trying to get all of the facts as clearly stated, as you know, you're interviewing people all around the person, biography, to make sure that the actual details are 100% true. And memoir is more your recollections of these events, and the truth of it is definitely up to you, but sometimes what you're trying to get to is the truth of the experience, which may not have anything to do with, you know, well, it didn't happen on June 7th, 1982. It happened on June 12th, 1983. Like, that part is really irrelevant. So I think memoir does have a little bit more wiggle room for fictionalizing because you're more trying to convey, I think, the feel of something, like the life, rather than like, you know, this is something I can cite in, you know, historical work about the events of June 7th, 1983, or whatever I just said.
So. I stay pretty close to the bone as much as possible because for me, inventing things is hard, and I like to just fall back on, like, well, and what actually happened. But I also think that it's like, you know, if I'm to do a portrait of you, it's going to wind up not looking exactly like you, but it'll be my interpretation of you. And people are telling me all the time as I draw people, like, you're very generous, like you like make people more attractive than they are. And I'm genuinely not trying to do that. This just the way that it turns out. And I think that those like personal biases are a little bit of fiction in that it's not exactly what happened, but it's true to your interpretation.
I agree that I think it's more about the experience than really about what really happened. As I said before, this is our own scripted documentary. We can really do whatever we want. I won't make up a completely different story, but for example, in my book, we're going to past experiences that in a situation where I get stuck in a guy's apartment during a blizzard and we can't leave, so we just stay up all night and talk about things that happened in the past. And that never happened. I mean, I never had a date with a guy and got stuck in a blizzard. But that was just a frame story for things that actually happened. So even though I made it up, I didn't feel like it takes anything from the that it makes the story less authentic because of that. This is just a frame story. I needed something to put everything together, so I come up with that. Sorry, guys, I don't think if you come up with minor details, it takes anything from the integrity of the story. But if you're really changing everything, then maybe you should have called it out of the group.
I was just going to say, I think that it can be so interesting to combine fiction and nonfiction, and especially if you're doing it explicitly and if you're talking about memory and the untrustworthiness of memory. And that's something like if I had to do my book again, I would take advantage of that more. Like, there's so many opportunities, I think, especially in comics, because you have the layers of images and text, and you can show reality and fantasy at the same time. And in my book, I did a couple places where I was like, this is my fantasy about what's going on, but it's not really, or this is the whole explanation I constructed for myself about why my mom had Alzheimer's. It actually wasn't true. But I think like there are really great opportunities in comics to push that further.
Yeah. And a great opportunity to do the speak directly to the reader and say, yeah, actually, I think it didn't happen this way, but let's just go with it. I wanted to call my book semi-autobiographical, but the publisher told me, we're going to go with memoir, because it's a marketing term.
Yeah, with my new book, ex-girlfriend got downgraded to a friend by my editor and me, because it was like too many girlfriends. It's like, you know, too distracting, and who cares? So like, let's just say she's a friend, and then you're like really upset when you guys stop being friends. That's like, okay. But she was like, it's memoir. It's not, you know, it's not biography. It's just, it's like, it serves the story. And it's, and also mm-hmm. like in Portland, there's so many people around all the time. It would really just burden the reader with a bunch of spare people that don't have any real anything. So there are people that were around in my life at times when I drew this, and they were like, I can't wait to see myself in the comic. And I'm like, well, you're not in there. Because unless you're like the main four players, like there's not a place for you. I can't have a community of people just like buzzing around every panel. But I still feel like I'm getting to the emotional truth of the thing. And I did tell that ex-girlfriend, I was like, I'm so sorry if you've been downgraded to a friend. even though we lived together, we were just roommates and buddies, and we had a dog together, but I'll figure out how to write that later. Any other cues? Panelists, is there one question you wish people would ask you about your work that they don't? Elizabeth?
Oh, well, I wish people would ask me if I want to go grab a coffee.
Well, if you log into the Somebody app by Miranda July, one of the options you can have, you can say, one of my friends is near Elizabeth. Go say hi to her for me and buy her a cup of coffee. So if you're not brave enough to do it, you can have someone else do it. Heather? Anything else you wish people would ask you that they don't ask you?
Well, I love when people talk about graphic styles and the actual artwork in my book, because because the preponderance of discussion I find tends to focus on the story or on the gender identity or, you know, those questions about gender and sexuality. And the fact is that I drew it as a comic for a reason. And that the artwork is as important to me as the story. Mm-hmm. So I always appreciate conversations that get into the comics aspect of it.
Actually, this doesn't really come up a whole lot. I don't think anyone has ever asked me this before, but choosing the terminology to use in the book was very difficult because terminology within the trans and genderqueer community is in flux. I started working on the book in 2008, at which point in time the word cis had not really become mainstreamed for referencing someone whose, you know, gender matches their plumbing at birth. And when I was... I didn't want to impose language on any of the people I was interviewing. I didn't want to tell them which terminology they should use. So I just went with whatever they said in their interview. And some of that terminology, I think, maybe people would be like, why did you say genetic man? Don't you realize that that's, you know, something, something? Or, and I was like, because that is what popped out of this person's mouth. And I wanted to be authentic, not only to what they were saying, but also to what the terminology, like that, there were points in time where certain terms were not, there was nothing wrong with them. But that changes as people enter the dialogue and say, well, actually, that's not a very representative term because of these reasons. And people are like, okay, let's then come up with a new word. And tracking the changes of language over time is very interesting to me. How does semantic drift alter what words mean and which words we choose to use? And so leaving it exactly as it was at that moment is also kind of a stamp of like, this is the best term that someone could come up with for this at this time. Mm-hmm. And it may not be the best term that we can come up with right now. And then in 10 years, we may have an even better term. But being able to watch the evolution of that is interesting to me. And so leaving that terminology as is kind of, I think that's important.
Yeah, it makes it a historical project.
Yeah.
I must say, we are just about out of time, so I wonder if you will tell us what you have to plug. What are you working on that you want us to buy? What's out now? What do you want us to do? Tell us what to do.
All right. You should buy this book. It's out there in the place where the books are being sold. I also have a new book out. Everything else I have out now is fiction. I have a new book out called Politically Incorrect, which is kind of snarky, gay sort of a thing, which if you like British comedy, it might be your sort of thing. If you really hate British comedy, it probably will not be your sort of thing. But that kind of, that sense of humor. And my new science fiction stuff, which is, I'm writing now queer YA, because there's not really a whole lot of stuff for young queer people that isn't sort of like, here are coming out stories, here are stories about bullying, here's stuff to make you depressed. So I'm trying to write kind of action adventure sci-fi for younger audiences, or appropriate for younger audiences, but also readable for adults as well.
Great.
I have these two books here, Bisexual Trials and Errors 1 and 2, which can be either bought off my person, I have some in my bag, or I'm going to be putting them where I hear books are being sold.
You mentioned another book.
Yeah, the one about the Lexington Club closing is not finished yet, even though I have an event for it on May 23rd. So, but you can get it in a few weeks at elizabethdrewu.com.
And what's the title?
I think it's going to be called We Belong, because that song, people just keep putting it on the jukebox, Pat Benatar. Yeah.
My comic book and work were actually surprisingly sold out at Mocha Fest, so I didn't print anything to sell today. I'm currently working on a graphic novel, Full Body Scan. Hopefully it will be ready by next year, next winter. I still don't know about North America, so for those of you who read French, it should be, hopefully will be available soon. You can check for updates on my website, just Google my name, or my Facebook. That's it. Thanks for coming.
There are some copies of my memoir, Tangles, I think at the book selling place, and in 2.5 years, maybe you can buy my next book, so it's not really late to start. We're never too early to start.
Do you have a title for that?
I believe it's called Agnes Murderous. It's about a serial killer.
Not a family member.
not your partner.
It's historical fiction. Okay.
All right, I've got Pregnant Butch over at the Prism Room. And a very beautiful silk screen of the cover is available for sale. Also there. Big.
That's exciting.
I don't have a publisher for the works that I'm working on, but we shall see.
You can get Calling Dr. Laura somewhere, a lot of places. Maybe at the book table, I don't know. I'm having a fundraiser for my dog's retinal surgery. GoFundMe.com/PonyoVisionFund. And Fetch, the story of how a bad dog brought me home, will be out with Hal Mifflin in 2017, if I finish it. Okay, thank you for coming. Thank you to my panelists.